Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Dann singt meine Seele, mein Gott, mein Retter zu dir, wie groß du bist, wie groß du bist. Dann singt meine Seele, mein Gott, mein Retter zu dir, wie groß du bist, wie groß du bist. Dann sings my soul, mein Savior God, zu thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen. Praise the Lord, church. You had no idea that you could understand that other language, did you? But you got every word in it. What a blessing it is to be in God's house within the greatness of God's presence. It is a blessing and an honor to have you joining us for worship today. Thank you so much for being with us and sharing in the good news of the gospel along with us and all of God's people from wherever we are worshiping. My name is Shawn Wallace, one of the pastors here at First Christian Church, and I just wanted to say a special thank you on behalf of me and the rest of the congregation for you joining us. We are in the middle of a worship series. I've been doing it for a couple weeks now, and we're going to go for a couple more weeks, called Revaluing Ourselves. And so if you have arrived at this point in life, maybe struggling your way through, or maybe wondering who you are, needing a little bit of encouragement, some good news spoken into you, then you are in the right place. We are looking at how God feels about us and who we truly are at our core. And so thank you for being here. I encourage you to prepare the way for the Lord this morning, to prepare a candle if you've got one, to recognize the light of Christ, to settle your heart and soul and to sink into this union and worship with God as we prepare ourselves, and to prepare your communion as well, some kind of loaf and cup that you could share in the Lord's Supper with us a little later in the service. But now I invite you to worship, to lift your voice, to sing with joy and gladness to God who has created us and who loves us.
Father God, I thank you for being a way maker. Lord, I thank you for being a miracle worker. Lord, I thank you for being a promise keeper, the light in the darkness. You singing, you are here.
You are here, turning lives around.
I worship you. You are here.
You are here.
You're a way maker.
Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper,
light in the darkness,
light in the darkness,
my God,
that is who you are.
just sing it again. Waymaker. Take that from the top. You are.
Good morning, First Christian Church. I'd like to read a few verses from Psalm 92. It is good to praise the Lord and make music to your name, O Most High, to proclaim your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night, to the music of the 10-string lyre and the melody of the harp, for you make me glad by your deeds, O Lord. I sing for joy at the works of your hands. How great are your works, O Lord! How profound your thoughts! The senseless man does not know, fools do not understand, that though the wicked spring up like grass and all evildoers flourish, they will be forever destroyed. But you, O Lord, are exalted forever. Let us pray. Holy Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for this day and the opportunity to come together as the body of Christ. We thank you for your scriptures and for the promises that they give us. We pray, Lord, that you would be with us as we hear your word spoken to us, as we sing praises to your name. We thank you for our Lord Jesus Christ, whose sacrifice gave us the opportunity to be united with you one day. We praise you, O Lord, and ask that you be with us now as we speak the words that Jesus taught us to say, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Glory be to the Father.
When they are small,
bearing fruit as they grow tall,
spreading Jesus' love through the rogers in the world.
Hi, boys and girls. How are you? I haven't seen you for a while. I'm sure we'll all be glad when we get back to church. I'll bet most of you are wondering what I have on, and most of you probably know it. Yes, it's my life jacket. It's a nice day, and I hope to go out on the boat, but you know, sometimes I get afraid of the big deep water, and I feel like I have to have some protection, so I have my life jacket on. I don't want to drown. And you know, Pastor Shawn today in his sermon is going to be talking about God's protection, and our lesson today is going to be about how God protects us. What do you think it means to protect? Think about that for just a minute. To protect means to keep us safe or from harm or from injury. So how does God protect us? In Ephesians 6, 10 to 18, boys and girls, we find out that God has given us an armor to wear to protect us. Isn't that cool? Armor, you might go, what's that? Armor is an outside covering, just like a life jacket, that protects us. And just like a life jacket, Jesus gives us strength to tell the truth, to be moral, or in other words, to do the next right thing, or to make the next right choice, and to be ready to share our love with Jesus with others. And Jesus says he'll put the shield around each of his kids. So boys and girls, Jesus promises he's gonna protect you at all times. And Jesus's armor, boys and girls, isn't something we can touch like a life jacket. It's strength that we have when someone asks us to lie about maybe who took the last cookie, or if to be a bully in school, or to tease someone because they shaved their head for the summer, or maybe because they're chubbier than other kids. Maybe it's they're trying to, you know, or to tease or to be mean to a brother or sister, or to talk back to parents or teachers. Jesus is there to help you, to protect you, and to give you the strength from the inside to not fall into those sins of the world. And how is this protection possible, you ask? Boys and girls, it's possible because Jesus loves each one of you so very, very, very much. And the Holy Spirit now lives inside of you, and that Holy Spirit helps you to make the right decision and to gives you the strength to not do what the world wants you to do, but what Jesus wants you to do. Our Bible verse today, boys and girls, is from 1 Corinthians 16:13, and it says, be on your guard, boys and girls. Stand firm in your faith. Be children of courage. Be strong. In other words, boys and girls, think for yourself and you decide what to do or say based on what you know about Jesus. And the verse then ends with, do everything with love. You know, boys and girls, I used to teach science and I love science experiments. I have an orange here and this orange has the peel around it. The peel is like God's protection. This piece of orange also has the peel on it, but I'm going to tear it off so that it no longer has its protection. And when I tear it off, it's not very strong anymore and it's kind of wobbly. Let's pretend that this water is the world. Let's see what happens when I drop it in without the protection. Oh my goodness, look at boys and girls. It gets drawn down to the very bottom of the water, the very bottom of the earth. But now, boys and girls, I'm going to put the orange in that still has the protection around it, still has the peel. Do you think the water, or if we pretend that this is the world, is going to make it sink, or will it be able to float? Look at that, boys and girls. The orange will float because it has the peel or the armor, the strength around it. Just like you will be able to succeed in this world, at school or at home, with God's protection. I ask all of you to pray with me. I'll start the prayer and then you say it after I start. Dear Jesus, help me to show your love to all my friends at school, all my family, and all my relatives. Let me have the courage to stand up to bullies or those that want to do wrong. Thank you for protecting me, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Becky, and thank you, kids, for participating in that. And we have this time to go to God in prayer, to share our joys and concerns with one another and with God. And so I invite you to go to our website at fccrogers.org, and there you'll find a prayer request tab. If you'll click on that, you can fill that out and share your concerns, your joys, things that you would like for us to join you in praying about. You can share those there. That will go to the pastors and the elders, and if you don't want that shared with the whole church, please let us know in that. If otherwise, we'll send that out in prayer matters so that others can pray with you as well. I do want to let you know that Marcia Black has asked for prayers for her granddaughter, Brooklyn Goad. Brooklyn tested positive for COVID-19 this past week, and so we pray for her to have mild symptoms and a quick recovery, a full recovery there. We continue to pray for everyone's safety in Northwest Arkansas, for the schools and the university, and many of which have been quarantined or shut down for cleanings and things like that, that we could continue to keep everyone safe. We continue to pray for our students, our teachers, administrators, everyone who works in those buildings to be able to keep them safe, and we pray for wisdom as they make decisions. As always, we pray for the leaders of our nation and our world who are making decisions right now that affect all of us, for our troops and first responders, for the ways that they put themselves in harm's way to protect us, for the people on the list there on the side of your screen today, that you would pray for them, not only today, but throughout the week. It's a joy that tonight we'll have worship on the lawn at 6:30. And so I hope to see many of you there. Bring your chair and communion and come join us for some great worship out on the front yard. And as always, it's a joy to worship together this morning through YouTube and in our homes and on our computers and iPhones and whatever you're watching it on, that that we could draw together in God's Spirit and worship the Lord. And so I want to give us a few moments now of silent prayer together, where you can share your own joys and concerns with a God who is waiting to hear from you. And then I'll have a prayer for us together. So let's pray. Oh, loving God, we thank you that you are a way maker. That even when we can't see you at work, that you never stop working for us on our behalf, working things out according to your good and perfect will. And so we come today to worship you, to sing your praises, and to be in your presence. So we ask that your Holy Spirit would come into every place where we are worshiping and allow us to feel your presence with us. Make yourself known to us. God, we thank you that that we can come to you with all of these needs, these concerns on our hearts, the desires of our hearts, and know that you are working them out. And so God, fill us with faith today, that if we are feeling like we're in distress and we call out to you, that you would hear our cries, that when we cry for help, that you would heal our land, that you would rescue us, that you would be our support and our way maker. God, we thank you for loving us enough to save us from our sins. And so we ask your forgiveness from all the ways that we have fallen short. When we have lost our tempers, when we have allowed our fear and anxiety to overcome us, when we have allowed addictions to creep back into our lives, when we have trusted anything and anyone more than we have trusted you, God, we ask that you would forgive us. But more than forgive us, God, we ask that you would continue to change us, shaping us into the image of Jesus Christ, our Lord, that we could be a true reflection of how much you love the world, of the grace and mercy that you offer to us. Allow us to offer that to those around us. God, we long to be a faithful church, a church that makes a difference in this world, that brings about the building of your kingdom, beginning right here in Rogers, Arkansas, or wherever we're watching and listening from, that you would use us. And we'll give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
The children of Israel walked the desert. For 40 years they wandered all around. Well, they cried out to God in all their hunger. And they knew when the manna came down. When he rains, it pours. He will open. When he rains, it pours. There were 5,000 on the hillside. Multitudes were waiting to be fed. Now folks still wonder how to fill them with just two fish and 5 loaves of bread. When he rains, it pours. He can open up heaven's doors. And he'll shower out a blessing your heart can't even store. When he rains, it pours. Once you have come to know the Savior, you've been washed in the blood. Prepare your heart for overflowing, 'cause it's about to come a flood.
Amen. Love when Sandy sings that song. I invite you into God's Word. Open up your Bible, turn to the book of Psalms, and find the 18th Psalm. Some really, really wonderful words of life for you and me today. And so I encourage you to read these along, maybe leave it open beside you so you can look back as we go along, but some beautiful words about how God cares about us and cares for us. Listen to these words as spoken by David. Psalm 18, beginning at verse 4, it says this. He says, "The cords of death entangled me. The torrents of destruction overwhelmed me. The cords of the grave coiled around me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called to the Lord. I cried to my God for help. From His temple, He heard my voice. My cry came before Him into His ears. The earth trembled and quaked, and the foundations of the mountains shook. They trembled because He was angry. Smoke rose from His nostrils. Consuming fire came from His mouth. Burning coals blazed out of it. He parted the heavens and came down. Dark clouds were under His feet. He mounted the cherubim and flew. He soared on the wings of the wind. He made darkness His covering, His canopy around Him, the dark rain clouds of the sky. Out of the brightness of His presence, clouds advanced with hailstones and bolts of lightning. The Lord thundered from the heavens. The voice of the Most High resounded. He shot His arrows and scattered the enemy. With great bolts of lightning, He routed them. The valleys of the sea were exposed, and the foundations of the earth laid bare. At Your rebuke, Lord, at the blast of breath from Your nostrils, He reached down from on high and took hold of me. He drew me out of deep waters. He rescued me from my powerful enemy, from my foes who were too strong for me. They confronted me in the day of my disaster, but the Lord was my support. He brought me out into a spacious place. He rescued me because He delighted in me." This is God's word for you and for me. Would you join me in prayer? Well, God, we thank You for Your care and Your love for each and every one of us. God, we pray and we call upon that care, that love right now. We call upon You to speak words of life, words of encouragement, words of hope, words that are unique to where we are today. God, speak into each and every one of our hearts in a way that each of us could understand, with messages that each of us need to hear. God, we pray that You would transform my body and my voice, that it would be Yours to use. God, speak through me and allow us all to know You better. We pray and ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, our hope, our Deliverer. And it's in His name that we pray, and we all together say, Amen. Amen. Sometimes I wonder if we are terrible parents. You know, our kids will occasionally come down the stairs lacking some article of clothing, and so Michelle, my wife, and I will encourage them, well, run back upstairs and grab your shoes, or hurry back up and get some socks. Y'all, you'd think that we were driving our own children into the claw-filled clutches of ogres. I mean, the deep, guttural laments of, "But I don't want to go upstairs. Insert sibling name here. Will you please come up with me? Mommy, will you please, please go upstairs with me?" For a while, though, our youngest cub, Matthias, he'd do the most fantastic thing with a deep breath and a flint-like brow, he would confidently proclaim, "God is with me. God is with me. God is with me," all the way up and back. Unfortunately, he refuses that tactic now, and he has resumed the pleading for another way, but I also believe that sometimes it's hard, even for us adults, to believe that God is with us. God is with us in the most difficult of times. Now, if you all have been participating in our daily meditations on Facebook, we've been walking through a chapter a day of 1 Samuel, and those of us who have been together, we've witnessed how King Saul, the man with all the power and all the resources at this particular time in history, he has literally been hunting and seeking to destroy the life of David, because David will one day become the next king. Saul has sought to use those that David loves. He's sought to employ them for his own ends as snares. He's commanded everybody around him, all the people that serve him, to kill David. He's dispatched thousands and thousands of men in pursuit of David's life. And it's from within the depths of these trials that a beleaguered and a besieged David composes the psalm that we just read. In fact, if you've got your Bible open, you can look at the introduction to that psalm there, and you'll see that it is David who writes this after he's been attacked by Saul, and Saul has been seeking his life. David was in a bad place. He describes his situation here. He says, the cords of death entangling me, the torrents of destruction are overwhelming me, the cords of the grave are coiling around me, the snares of death are confronting me. This is more than just a bad day. This is more than just a kind of a tough situation. David feels those tendrils of death wrapping around his body, encircling his soul, dragging him back and down into the grave. But David chooses to respond in the best and the most powerful way possible. He calls out to God. He fervently prays with all of his heart and soul. And look at this. Look in verse 6. In verse 6, we are suddenly welcomed into a vision of God's temple in heaven. The veil is pulled back, and we can see David's cry coming to God. David's voice and prayers enter into God's ears. Now here's the first thing that I want us all to hear and to take to heart today. Sometimes we think that God does not hear us. I mean, God's got so much going on, big problems in our world, we can all attest to that, bigger things going on, but I believe that God is so big. God is so caring. God is so capable. Is he able? Yes, he's able. That God hears every single prayer that anybody ever speaks, no matter how small. And this psalm, Psalm 18, that supports that, it says, "My voice, my cry came into God's ears." Not through some mediator, not because it was more important than anybody else, but simply because God hears me and my voice. My friends, you and I, we are close enough. We are in a close enough relationship to be able to speak directly into the ear of God. And y'all see what happens next, right? The Lord mobilizes. God gets angry. Angry? Yes, the text says God gets angry. Smoke billows from his nostrils. Fire flares from his mouth. God rips open the heavens and thunders down to the earth. Hailstones and bolts of lightning. He scatters the enemy with holy arrows. He routs them with thundering blasts of white-hot lightning. The earth itself trembles and quakes. The foundations of the mountains shake. Things are not right. God is angry, and even the earth responds to God's movement. It kind of reminds me a little bit of a time when our oldest daughter, Layla, was either in kindergarten or first grade, but she decided that she wanted to purchase this overpriced, scented pencil at school. Insert dad eye roll here. But Layla used her own money, and it was that important to her. It meant that much to her, and so she wanted it that badly. So she marched her dollar bill up to school that day, and she joyfully purchased the sweet aroma-infused, rubber-butted, wood-wrapped graphite writing utensil of her dreams. Later that same day, a certain boy asked her to trade pencils. And so Layla's trusting little heart gave him her pencil, but then he refused to give her his pencil. Now let me tell you, that broke our hearts. I mean, Mama cried, literally cried, but Daddy was about two breaths away from thundering up to that school and hunting down the little five-year-old pencil-snatching burglar and fixing that situation right then and there. Of course, I decided that may not be the best course of action, but I can completely relate to God's actions here. When my child is unjustly hurt and attacked, when she is struggling, when her little heart breaks and she grieves from the depths of her soul, my heart breaks too. And that is the second thing that I really want us to know today, to remember today, that not only does God hear our cry, but not only does God heed our prayer, but our God acts. Compassion necessitates that. Love requires that. If God is love, as 1 John says, then God is not idle. God does not merely stand by on the sidelines. God does not just watch and observe. No, God responds. God moves. God engages. However, over time, some of us, I know, have lost faith in that. We've lost faith in that God is with me. God is with me. Sometimes we lose trust and we don't really believe that anymore. Even if we accept that God does hear us, we still feel like we are entering that darkness alone. That we have to take care of this ourselves. But you know, y'all, it's hardest to see in the dark. And so that, I believe, is the moment in life. That's the time, the instance where we need the most faith. That's where we need these scriptures like this that remind us not only of God's love, but also of God's action. Because often it's only in the looking back. Often it's only after we have emerged from that darkness. Often it's only after we have come through that we then can see the ways that God actually did tear open the heavens and scatter our enemies and shake and alter the landscape around us. Often it's only after we've been brought up into that spacious place that then we can see how God actually tenderly reached all the way down down into our lives, stretched from heaven deep down into the deep, and gently lifted us out of those bottomless waters, the waters that we thought we drowned in. And why? Why? Here is the absolute most important thing for us to know today. If you hear nothing else, hear this. Why does God do all of this? Why does God listen to us? I mean, to broken people and people who mess up. Why does God get involved with us? Why does God act for us? Why does God choose to rescue us? As Psalm 18 says, because God takes delight in you and in me. Not because we deserved it. Not because we had done nothing wrong. Not because we were perfect or good enough in some way. But simply because God takes delight in you. That feeling of love and care when our children are hurt. That feeling of joy and excitement when they finally get it and finally do it. That feeling of hope and encouragement when our children enter into the darkness. That feeling of, I am with you, I promise I am with you. That feeling, that's how God feels about us. Because God delights in you and in me. Your life strikes the deepest of heart chords in God. So much so that God would descend down from on high. God would move heaven and earth. God would fight battles for the protection and care of the one that God delights in. Would you pray with me? Oh God, sometimes we forget who we are. Sometimes we forget who you are and what you have promised. And so today, God, remind us once again. Give us a faith where our faith is weak. Give us the strength to lean on what you have said about us more than what others have said about us. God, help us to know and to see ourselves with the delight that you see when you look at us. And then, oh God, help us to see our brothers and sisters that same way as well, with love and compassion, with encouragement and joy. God, we thank you for making us your own. Thank you for hearing us and working with us and acting for us, for protecting us and guiding us. We say and we pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. My friends, I offer the opportunity to receive this good news today, to make a life change, to stake your life on this, because this is what faith is. It's trusting in what God says and who God says you are, and then walking into that life. If you have some parts of your life that you need to change and alter because you haven't been living into the fullness of who God has called you to be and that goodness that God sees in you, then this is your chance to make a change from this moment forward. I encourage you to make a commitment to God now, to change your life, to turn a corner, to finally kick that bad stuff out and beside and to say, you know what, I'm leaving that behind. I encourage you to pray to God to have some time of dialogue with God and to share how you will be different from this day on. We'd love it if you'd call the office, call my cell phone, talk to us. We'd love to pray with you and fight this battle alongside you and be the voice and presence of God along with you if we can. And so call us and let us know as well. But let's all give thanks to God, in addition to praying to God, by lifting our voices and singing with joy and with thanksgiving to God. Let's sing together.
while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
I encourage you to prepare your table there at home, bread and cup, so that you can share with us in this Holy Communion. If you're in a place where you feel abandoned by God, that where you feel that maybe God has forgotten you or is not working in your life or in your situation, if you feel overwhelmed by life, then this table is where you need to be. Because it's at this table where we remember Jesus, our Lord and Savior, God's one and only Son, who hung on a cross for doing absolutely nothing wrong. Where we remember his disciples gathered together wondering what could have gone so wrong, how they could have trusted this man and watched him die. Where we remember the women who ran to the tomb ready to prepare his body for burial and found the tomb empty, for he had risen just as he said. God is at work doing things that we can't even imagine, even in the hardest and most difficult times of our lives. So as we come to this table, we remember these words from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. It says, "For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took a cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Would you pray with me? Oh God, we ask your blessing on this bread and this cup, that they might become for us symbols that remind us of Jesus' body and blood given for us. Symbols that remind us of your power, even in the hardest of times. Symbols that remind us of your love, even in the midst of our sin. Symbols that remind us that you forgive and love and restore. So use this time to speak to us in our heart of hearts. Help us to know how much you love us. In Jesus' name, amen. we do this in remembrance of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ.
Good morning, everyone. I hope you are enjoying these brisk mornings. I know I am. As we give back a portion of what God has given us this morning, just take a moment and think about what God has given you. Is it a job? Is it a home with a wonderful family? Is it good health? I could go on and on. My point is, I hope God has blessed you over and over. I know he has blessed me and my family abundantly. I would like to read a scripture this morning from 2 Corinthians verses 6 through 9. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. In a moment, your screen will show you the various ways that you can give this morning. Let us pray. Dear Lord, I thank you for your many blessings that you have bestowed upon us, this church family, and upon our great nation. We are so blessed to live in a free country and to worship you freely. Let us now give back with a cheerful heart a portion of what you have given unto us. Amen. I hope to see you all this evening at 6:30 for the worship on the lawn. Have a great day.
Hey friends, I know that you hear me every week say like and subscribe. If you don't know what those words mean, there is a thumbs up button right down here. And if you want to click that, it says you like this video. We love that. It helps us. If you want to click the bell right over here, that's what the subscribe is, that you get a notification whenever we upload a new worship service or something to our channel. We always encourage you to share the good news. Share these things on Facebook and invite a friend to come worship with you or to share worship with you online. It's such a blessing to be together and to be able to have this opportunity to worship God, even when we can't be physically together in the sanctuary. But we are incredibly excited to be able to announce that we are going to begin weekly worship again. I know that all of us have been eagerly hoping for this. It will still not be exactly the way it used to be, but we are going to be worshiping on the lawn every Sunday beginning today. So today the worship is at 6:30 because that's what we had planned. But starting next Sunday, worship on the lawn will be at 5 p.m. Every Sunday. And so you can come and gather, and we hope that many folks will gather together, practice distancing, and keep everyone safe. Wear a mask, wear your mask, bring a chair and communion. But it'll be good to be in community together as we worship. There's something holy, and we are thankful that we will be able to be outside within God's good creation and enjoy these beautiful days in the weeks ahead. So I hope to see you there. Hope that you will join us 6:30 today and then 5 o'clock on the Sundays following. We will still do online worship, going live at 9:30 every Sunday. So worship with us however is best for you. And if you would now connect yourself to somebody who's worshiping there with you, either beside you or if there's nobody there with you, then let your heart connect to somebody that you love and receive this blessing. As you go from this time, may you feel the very hand of God reaching down and drawing you up out of the deep waters that have sought to overwhelm you. May you feel the broad space that God is placing you in, the wide open spaces full of God's presence. Then go from this place, knowing who you are and whose you are, and love not only your children with that love, but love all of God's children with that same love and compassion and care. Bear witness to the goodness of God in this world and in all people. In the name of Jesus the Christ, God the Father, and the Holy Spirit, all of God's people said, Amen.